We've learned from Stokes' theorem that if the flow is irrotational, it can be written like this. So we have the line integral around some closed surface of v dot ds, that's equal to zero for an irrotational flow. And we can just draw a picture of what that looks like. We have some closed surface, and we've got ds, the vector ds along the curve. And throughout that region, we have some velocity flow field. And so at any point here, if you take v dot ds and then integrate that over this closed surface, that equals zero. So that's for an irrotational flow. Okay, another thing that we learned is that integral, or the solution of that integral, is independent of its path, as long as that surface is closed. Now, if we have an object inside of that surface is not closed. But if we take that integral along a closed path outside of the object, just in the flow field, then it's a closed surface, and for an irrotational flow, that integral equals zero, independent of path. Okay, so I'm just going to write that down there. Independent of path. Now, if there's a closed integral that is or an integral on a closed surface that is independent of path, that means that this is an exact differential. And that's a mathematical term that requires, we can write the exact differential of a scalar, d phi. Basically, that requires that exact differential can be written as del phi, del x. So the partial of phi with respect to x, dx, plus the partial of phi with respect to y, dy, plus the partial of phi with respect to z, dz. So if something is an exact differential, then it can be written this way. Now, we can actually take that v dot ds and notice that is a v dot ds, that's the dot product of two vectors. And so that's actually a scalar that we are integrating over this closed surface. So we can say that v dot ds is equal to some d phi, some scalar that we're integrating over that. And that scalar is an exact differential. Okay, so let's write out what v is actually. So v can be expressed as vx in the x direction plus vy in the y direction plus vz in the z direction. And ds, this differential along the surface, that can be expressed as dx in the x direction plus dy in the y direction plus dz in the z direction. So v dot ds is equal to d phi. So we can say that d phi, that's equal to v dot ds. And we can just do the dot product of these two vectors. And what we get there is going to be vx dx plus v sub y dy plus v sub z dz. We can equate these two equations. And so we can now write out vx, for example, is equal to del phi, or the partial of phi with respect to x, vy is equal to the partial of phi with respect to y, and vz is equal to the partial of phi dz. Okay, so another way to write our velocity vector here, if we take our velocity vector and plug in these values here, what we get is that we can write our velocity vector as d phi dx, or the partial of phi with respect to x in the x hat direction, plus the partial of phi with respect to y in the y hat direction, plus the partial of phi with respect to z in the z hat direction. Okay, so, or actually we can take this one step further, and that is that v is equal to the gradient of phi. So any velocity field that can be expressed as the gradient of a scalar function is called a potential flow. So any velocity field that can be expressed as the gradient of some scalar function is called a potential flow, and that scalar function is what we call the velocity potential. Now, from Stokes's theorem, if we come back up here, for an irrotational flow, so this is Stokes's theorem, what that means is that any flow that is irrotational, that means that it will also be a potential flow. Okay, so any flow that is irrotational will also be a potential flow.